Hello all, thank you for coming in the session. Thank you for joining Voxxed Days Luxembourg. The idea in this discussion we will have and the presentation is to speak a little about the transition of the security from the early days to mid ages and then to the new era of the cloud. The idea is a little bit to for you to understand what are the necessary changes that you have to do on all the layers of your infrastructure, software development processes, and so forth. So, like a holistic view of what changed and how the infrastructure and how the software development process evolved the last, let's say, 5 years rapidly, that required a mind shift on how we see and how we understand security at the moment. So, this will be the main concepts that we will be speaking about. So, quickly. So the name is Nikolaos Ballas. For those of you who know me, it's typical. It's way too Greek for everyone. Let's stick to Nick, okay? A daytime job, a cloud, blah, 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 and architecture in Eurofins, in essence, an engineer at heart and still a handsome guy, okay? Most of the night times I hack, I take projects, I do projects on my own. And of course, the target is always learning, which I hope everyone does. And what's my passion here? It's evidently distributed systems and computing, but also I love technical scuba diving. I'm an avid technical scuba diver. Whatever you will see, it is a common effort of a team that I built in the company I work for. So it's a collective knowledge that we build as a team and we manage to implement in the company I work for, which is Eurofins. So shout out to the X-Men team. And so a little bit of agenda, so a little bit of understanding how the flow we will go. So we will speak and we will discuss about an overview of security models. Then we will move on to the different phases of the security models on the software systems and how this thing evolved, okay? And then we will split a little bit in and we will drill into the details on each of these era. We'll speak about what are the clickbaits, like what are the huge buzzwords that everyone is using in order to speak about how good they are to security, okay? And then we will focus on how you should approach security, okay? Of course, it could take long. If we get to the point where we can see an example with code in a full life cycle, we will do that. If you prefer, we do a Q&A session before that so I can answer questions, that would be all. And then key takeaways, like what are the five big things that I want you to have in your head after leaving this room? And then a Q&A. So let's say the last three, I would leave it up to you to guide me what you prefer doing, right? So the security models most likely can be categorized in three big categories, right? Depending on the sector you are. So for example, if we speak about military, okay, in the military, most of the times you have isolation between networks, and that is the operational network of the army is not the same network that connects people from the army to internet. Most of the times these two networks are fully segregated. The one is totally closed and you need to have physical access to hardware of the army. So that's the one extreme. Then we moved from that isolation level to what was called perimeter-based security. And what's that? That is either you have physical access to a data center, like let's say 70s, 80s, where you had access to the machines and your card was granting you access to the systems. Most likely people who could not code or didn't have the necessary knowledge could never enter on those environments. And lately when clouds manifested, let's say the last 15 to 20 years, a new model, it didn't manifest, but it became dominant, which is the zero trust based security model. As a poll here, how many of you understand the difference between the second and the third? Okay, give me an example of a perimeter.
Perimeter can be a company. You have you secure access to the land of your company, and so you have firewalls outside, like a castle.
Perfect. So this is a great answer. Another similar example is if we go to Windows-based architectures, what we call domain, right? This is your perimeter. Your domain is your perimeter. Your DMZ zone is like the gatekeeper to that domain. And many things then become really strange. Now, I would like to spend a little bit of time now and reflect of what are the differences between the perimeter-based security and the zero-trust-based security. And the best thing or the best example that I come up with, it's how you secure your house. Okay, so traditionally now, the houses have a perimeter-based security system, which is what? When someone needs to enter your house, okay, most of the time he knocks on your door, and therefore you either have an easy way to see who that guy is, or you have a video camera in your ring bell, so you have a ring or something similar. You see him, and you say, okay, this is the person that is allowed to enter to my house. Now, that person, after he passed that door, okay, he can access everything in your house. So he can go to your bedroom. Hopefully he's more discreet than that, but he can go to your kitchen, he can open your fridge, he can take a beer, he can sit play with you something in your Xbox, but you never question his identity again. Okay, the only reason you will question his identity is if he's trying to do something that makes you feel uncomfortable. This is called, in the perimeter-based security approach, a privilege escalation systems like PAM, okay? What those systems do is, if I'm authenticated on a perimeter, still what I'm trying to do with that perimeter requires privilege escalation because someone dictated that. But if the resources in that network do not require privilege escalation, the only reason that I will, let's say, be requested again to authenticate is either there's a time to live in a Kerberos token or something similar on my LAN, or because I disconnected. In zero trust, the idea is you don't trust anything. If I take now again the paradigm, imagine there is no doorbell. So it sounds like Matrix, but that's how it is, right? Imagine there is no doorbell. And what happens is you enter in the room and you make a claim. Okay, the claim is what? I, as Nick, I'm stating that I can play Xbox in your house. And then there is a service that tells me, like, okay, authenticate, make your claim, okay? And if you're authorized, then suddenly in that space, it's in front of you, an Xbox with a television will start and you will be able to play. But if you decide to use the free service, then maybe the guy will tell you, no, you are not allowed to touch, for example, the fridge and take something because your age is not correct. Like, I have beers, you are under 16, you are not allowed to go in. So these two, let's say, different models have different pros and cons that we will exploit a little bit further down. So speaking a little bit around late 70s up until 90s, okay, most of the times the security of system was something that was baked in the system, okay? So what is that? Most of the operating systems back then, they had baked in all those processes. Like, you should provide a username and password to connect either to a time sharing system, or if we take traditional manifestation of Unix environments, there you should provide your username and password. And they had some kind of privilege escalation principles to allow you to do more difficult things, right? And the security, as explained also previously, it was, you know, based on what you can access physically. Like, in a university, most like people that were working on the data center, or students could go in and use the machines. A guy passing outside of the university that has nothing to do with the university could never access a vector machine. Okay? So that was the era of a baked-in, all-included security in your system that was relying on a physical access, validation, and credentials to use the system. But we grow bigger. And suddenly we decided that, okay, we should build data centers. And instead of each of us trying to build his own data center at home, we will co-host our data centers. So what we will be deploying there, so all the critical resources for the services, for our company, for our project, for everything to work, are deployed there, okay? And of course, now the data center has built-in gatekeepers and built-in doors that will allow you and grant you the access to it, okay? Nowadays, let's say the stack there we see is based either on Windows farms, so where it's a domain-driven design and so forth, or you have Linux-based systems. Those two models, again, most of them rely on Kerberos. Kerberos was an open protocol designed in Berkeley. Still, comparing the two implementations are totally different. Microsoft went their own way. Okay, and the Kerberos implementation of Windows is not fully compatible to what you will find in Windows. I believe you will hear many horror stories of people trying to domain join Linux boxes to domain controllers. So, as I explained in the past, once you entered and you validated your account, if you are not an administrator or someone who has escalated privileges, you will never be asked again to authenticate. And how did we give access to people to those resources? The glory era of VPN. Everyone has a VPN client in his laptop. If the companies, or let's say if the administrators are good enough, they will do a split VPN. I hope we are all familiar with what split VPN is. Yes, no. Okay, split VPN is the technology where we send to the data center only the traffic that needs to go to the data center. All the other goes through our normal, let's say, internet line. And a lot of people build DMZ zones. They build amazing firewalls, amazing firewall rules of how you can protect yourself. But many companies have suffered from security breaches. Best case scenario, you had a very nice SOC team that identified what is happening and quickly cut out the intruders. But lately, the last, let's say, 4 years with the rise of what is called ransomware, there are companies that have suffered total loss of their infrastructure. And for many of those, this created also a catastrophic fiscal event. There are companies that were locked out by, let's say, ransomers like Ryuk, that they never managed to recover financially. So even though it looks good, it has its pros and cons. I will not say it has died. No, the data centers are here to stay. What we decided to do is like, okay, instead of all of us doing design of data centers, let people who know how to design them to use them, and we will consume them as a service. How many of you have worked for a company that had such a security incident, even though everyone believed it is a secure environment? I think all of us have heard a horror story. And then 1993, 1994, the era of the internet arises. What is that? So whatever now was in my data center, using this amazing protocol designed in CERN called HTTP, I can offer it now through the web to other people. And then another pile of problems, I will call them like that, manifested. What happened? Development became not a commodity, but more and more companies wanted to develop software, right? So they started to expose services they wanted to offer over the internet, okay? And they said the people consuming that are using also the internet in order to consume our services. Again, there was some sort of like basic authentication most of the times that was correlating with a database table that was holding username, password, credentials. It was really good if it was encrypted. There are still systems today that hold credentials non-encrypted, okay? And we start to use things like TLS, asymmetric key encryption, to guarantee that the channel works properly and also gives anonymity. And everyone came now to do cloud. Cloud was the next step of the internet, which was, now there is no need to have a data center. There's someone else giving me resources for that, so I don't need to manage that. And the only thing I care about is to develop software to deploy on it. Fallacies. It's someone else's problem. I don't need to care for that data center. It is cheap and secure because I can do it easily. Anyone can open something on any of the famous cloud providers and move on. Okay. It will automatically modernize my application. I can go back and say, I'm deploying in Azure, I'm deploying in AWS, and suddenly I'm a cool kid on the block. And then a lot of people simply crash land. The complexity is enormous. Many people forget that those are, in a sense, distributed systems, right? Distributed systems in its nature are really difficult. They are really difficult to manage. They are really difficult to orchestrate. They are really difficult to understand and comprehend the complexities of those. So what happened is that we started now to understand that we need to change the way we see security. Right? We need to understand that the security that was done in traditional ways, which is, what is the traditional way? There is a security team somewhere in your organization that has a pile of papers in which when you write code or when you establish infrastructure, you need to read. And then you need to see, okay, you comply with those documents, yes or no. If you get ticked, you are safe. If you are not ticked, you are not safe. That also has been proven that it's really problematic, right? So there is a debate, people stating that the perimeter-based approach is easier because not a lot of people control resources. And these are, there are people that believe that the zero trust model is the way to move forward. As you understand, I'm advocate of the second, right? So what is in essence the zero-based trust? The zero-based trust is a security model, and the security model dictates that the identity of a user sits in the middle of the security framework. I don't care what you believe, but only if you are authenticated and authorized, you can use any kind of system. And this creates another problem, which is how we manage the life cycle of an identity, how we can validate an identity, and how that, though, can be managed correctly, okay? Again, we go to the little bit of a golden standard, which is the zero trust model is not something you do only in your application. It's something that is a full layered architecture. So it goes from your lower layer, how you deploy your switches, how you are setting up your VLANs and so forth, doing micro segmentation or next generation firewalls or anything like that. And it moves up to the development stack. And the development stack now is what people develop, okay? And how that changes and why you should not be using Windows integrated security and why you should move to what is called federated authentication. So all those things are hyped. And I will say there are a few things that are not well understood. For example, how many of you are familiar, again, a poll, how many of you are familiar with what it is called identity brokering? Let me give you a use case. So I have an identity. Who is familiar with the identity provider concept? Perfect. So most of the people believe that the company needs to have one identity provider, right? I have a central federated IDP, and I showcase or I point everyone to that there. The identity brokering is the capability of two identity providers to play the role of the authenticator and of the client. So I access and I go to the IDP A. I'm making a claim there stating this is my, for example, my credentials. And that IDP will say, okay, based on what you gave me, there's another IDP that I will redirect you that will authenticate you. Okay? This allows you to build a network of distributed IDPs that can have a segregation of duty of whom they authenticate. Okay? Again, nothing that is not covered by the Oath 2 specification. And now we will focus a little bit on the security in the cloud era, mostly speaking about the software development process, okay? So how many of you believe that security is something that we do at the end, or we do it while we develop, or it needs to be baked in from day zero? How many systems have you built that at the end someone told you, and what about security? And then everyone panicked that they needed to introduce the security layer there, because suddenly that service will be exposed to the internet. We have perfect developers here, I believe. Right? Yes, no? But I believe you all understand what I mean, right? So the other problem, as you can see, because the identity is the center of what I do and not the device, right? Because I can access the resources from my PC, from my PC given by the company, from my mobile phone, from everywhere, right? So this no longer adapts to the perimeter-based security where the physical devices are part of the trusted network, right? So it's really also, you have to start thinking that also the things you see around the perimeter of the identity have their own identity. What is the cool name for those things? They call it bring your own device, they call it Internet of Things, whatsoever. At the end, what you need to be able to say is that this device has something that it can be identified and correlated with my identity. And this will allow me to access the services I want. So the identity becomes now a critical part of your software development lifecycle process. And also, you should start deploying what is called shift left security. Who is familiar with the term? The rest are not interested, they don't know it, or they do not want to speak about it. We will see an example later. Shift left security is, again, if there is an axis that describes how my product evolves, the shift left security states that the security frameworks you want to implement need to be as close as to the software development as you can. Okay, that entails even patching of an operating system. Okay, but here you have to see that it's really important that you need to start thinking not in terms of what are the devices or what is your perimeter, okay, but how you will validate an identity. That is the first most critical part. And the second most critical part is access to data. What I mean by that, for example, I think Microsoft has done a very interesting implementation. You can find it in Microsoft Security Platform, part of the AAD, which is called conditional access policies. What is that? If my device, which is not a company-owned device, registers in a tenant, okay, it has specific rules it needs to comply with first in order to have access to the tenant. Again, it is the implementation behind the scenes is based on Oath and similar protocols. But also, my identity there clearly dictates what kind of data I can download or I cannot download on my device, okay? Because of course, in the past, when you had, let's say, data center-based approach, we have infiltration of people that they were simply going and getting dump of databases, making them publicly available. And I believe you all have heard this famous wall of shame that many companies suffered from. So now, we have to see that actually our development process needs to adapt. We can no longer have this traditional way of thinking, okay, I will write my code, I will write my Java.NET, whatever framework I'm using. And at a certain point in time before going to production, someone magically will tell me, okay, here's the security, we patch it in, we are done, we are live in production. It doesn't work any longer this way. So, as I stated, that is the software development process that needs to change, but also the mindset of how you do architecture in hardware needs to change, okay? And that is when you deploy a system, okay, that system needs to be able to support federated protocols. You need to be able to manage the identity of the system, okay? And as more and more people are trying now, or let's say, the barrier between what is called software and what is called hardware is a little bit fuzzy. We are looking now what people call full stack developers. I call them simply really good engineers. I believe that people need to be able to understand the environment their software executes, or else you are something different, okay? And of course, a PAM system should be part of your infrastructure without any second doubt, okay? And of course, you should use next generation firewalls. who is familiar or understands the difference between a firewall and the next generation firewall? I mean, typical example, an IP tables is a next generation firewall. Remember answering, no, I don't know, I don't understand, let's elaborate. It's also a valid answer to this question, right? So IP tables is not a next generation firewall, which that would be the obvious answer. Now, the reason is why. The reason is why IP tables is simply something that looks at static rules and then grant network level access to a resource. It will tell you someone came from that IP in that port and it is allowed to go in that IP in that port. It will not validate any identity. It will not do any authentication of who is there, because okay, you are in layer 4 or lower, but still you have all the packets with all the information that was provided, right? But you know what is the payload. So the next generation firewalls actually bring this feature in. You can authenticate and validate the packets, right? So they sit in the edge of those, let's say, zero trust networks, okay? It's imperative for me that also now the infrastructure becomes code. I'm a huge advocate of infrastructure as a code. I believe in it because I like immutable architectures. I like immutability in general. I think it's a good feature to have inside your code. Why not in your infrastructure? Why though? I think a lot of us will agree that immutability in the code is really evident, right? It solves many problems, like how you scale, how you do multi-threading, all those things go away. Right? You don't need to care for many of the typical problems. But why it is important also in infrastructure? Any obvious answer that you are willing to say? Again? Not precisely. Security is a byproduct of what we will discuss. Anything else? So, let's elaborate on it. Who is familiar with the concept of disaster recovery? All of you. Who has the problem that suddenly the data center went down and someone called you at 2 o'clock in the night, oh my God, everything is down, servers are down, systems are down, people start to build VMs, start to build servers and so forth, and someone calls you, you need to deploy. It's like, okay. Best case scenario, you have a CI/CD pipeline and you try to deploy. You deploy your application in the server that was given to you, but guess what? It doesn't work. Why? Because someone, for example, decided to patch a Linux server with the latest glibc version and it's not compatible with your software. So what immutability gives us is the capability to reproduce environments in a consistent way. Of course, then all those SLAs and OLAs that your environments need to comply with in order to recover are really easy and also make the life of the security person easier because he can replay the same state always, right? So yes, security is one of the byproducts, but it is an eventual, let's say, benefit. And of course, something that for me is imperative, and I know that there are a lot of problems convincing companies in investing in PKI. How many of you are familiar with what PKI is? Perfect. How many of you are working in a company that has invested in a proper PKI solution? Give me the definition of the proper PKI solution. Example. Of what you have in your infrastructure that you call PKI and gives you all the features of a PKI system.
It's an infrastructure which is able to receive requests for generating certificate and which is able to deliver certificate.
I will disagree a little bit on that because PKI stands for public key infrastructure. It doesn't say certificate infrastructure, correct? Because again, Another thing that a lot of people misunderstand, certificates are an easy way to prove identity. But certificates are a byproduct of a famous paper back in 1968, which was called Evolution of Cryptography, Asymmetric Key Encryption. If we don't have asymmetric key encryption, we cannot have certificates. A certificate without the public key or the private key is nothing, correct? So the problem that many people have in understanding how critical that is, the problem is not how you create a certificate, but how you are managing the stuff that create a certificate. Where are you storing the keys? How you manage the life cycle of the keys? So a proper, for example, PKI solution is someone who has an HSM device. An HSM device is a hardware device where you store the private keys, and most of the times it's an expensive device, okay? And if you go and touch the device on top of it, or if it understands that there is a difference of 2 degrees inside your data center, it will flash the keys, and automatically it will invalidate all the keys. Consequently, all the certificates that were issued using those private keys are no longer valid, okay? And again, a typical fallacy. People believe that because, for example, you are using a SEA, okay, you solved the PKI problem. No. The cool thing about crypto is that it took exactly that security problem and made it a secret management problem, okay? So again, yes, people will speak about security and they will say, okay, we are doing certificates and we are safe. No, you are not. Because again, creating a certificate is easy. How many of you have been in the case where, oh, the guy forgot to update the certificate? The certificate is, for example, TLS 1.0 and has expired 2 days. And suddenly, all services are breaking. A proper PK infrastructure will automatically roll the certificates for you. Okay? That's why, again, PKI, I cannot advertise it how important it is, and it is central to what we call zero trust. Because that's where you can create the what it is called confidence interval. Who is familiar with the concept of confidence interval and how this is defined? So probably he has done a lot of security in his life. So confidence interval is a measurement that states, okay, in order for me to start a discussion about establishing a connection with a person, I need a certain level of trust. And that's where security most of the time breaks. Because instead of having a low confidence interval, so trusting as less as possible, we tend to trust a lot. Okay? So do PKI, explain to the people why a PKI solution is important. A typical example of, again, how a PKI solution is bundled together. How many of you are using what it is called Vault solutions? Do you consider that Vault solutions are PKI solutions? They are not. It's a way to store secrets, but it's not a PKI solution. It helps you, for example, when in your Kubernetes cluster you want to inject secrets in your manifest files. Then you could use Azure Key Vault, AWS have something similar. There's a product from HashiCorp called Vault that allows you to connect it and hook it to the interface of Kubernetes, and then this will serve your secrets. Is it a PKI? No, it's not a PKI. It is a secret storage system. Oh my God, time flies. So again, now we will see an example, because as my famous beloved IT guru was saying, that Linux, Torvalds, talk is cheap. You need to show me the code. Okay, let me escape from here. Yes, we believe in you. Yes. Another question. How many of you, by default, always use multi-factor authentication on all the services they have? This includes accessing your GitHub. So, in a room, I don't know with how many people, five consider that MFA is important. It should be your second nature, right? It should be your second nature. Like, you should use MFA with almost everything you do. I mean, either ways, banks will not be here where they are without MFA. So let's go to the typical environments you all know. Yes. And of course, an ID we all love to hate, which is called IntelliJ. Okay, it's an amazing thing. Who still uses Eclipse? I want to see people using Eclipse. Don't be afraid. It's okay. We all do mistakes in our lives, and we can live with that. By the way, how many of you are developers here? That's an interesting thing. Okay. How many of you are infrastructure guys? How many of you believe they are both? Yes. So, yes, I trust the project. Let's hope so that the internet will work for us. No. Come on. Okay. I will trust my phone better. Yes. Let's give it another shot. Connected.
You should see your casino free wifi.
It doesn't work for me. I don't know for which reason, but the internet there is not passing through. Where is my Chrome? Let's restart. Okay, most likely now it will work. Please. So let's start by the code and then we move. So forget the name of the project at the moment. Okay, that is night hacking. So, for example, here you can see that I have my Kubernetes, I have my Terraform stack. Okay, and let's take, for example, services. And here you can see the typical file someone would expect to find in, I think I can go to presentation mode. Yes. It should become bigger. Yes. Okay. So here the important part is that in the software development world, the artifact to deliver is no longer your jar. The artifact to deliver is actually the container. That's what gets deployed, not your jar. If you are really doing DevOps, if it is a jar, if it is a Python thing, who cares? Your DevOps guy will tell you, tell me how you build the container, and then I will deliver you a container running in production, okay? Now, here you will see something that I'm a huge advocate of, and I think I have at least one friend that we did a lot of work on those things, which is called the Docker Builder pattern. What is the Docker Builder pattern? The environment which I built is the same as the environment where I execute, so the container itself builds my code, okay? So this makes sure, this ensures that the libraries that I want in order to compile my code will be the same as I will have in the runtime environment most of the times. Okay? And of course, here you will find nothing more than a typical Java project. Okay? Like, using the latest things. But now we need to see how the mentality needs to change, right? So, oh my God, no. So in order to connect to the casino network, do I need something special or?
This one is locked. Normally you should see the casino free Wi-Fi. But just the first one, yes.
Perfect. I love you all, but when I see casino free Wi-Fi, I always use my VPN provider. There is no shame to use VPN for your laptops, eh? No shame. No, let's go to Germany. Sorry, I know it's a French-driven convention, but the German access there is a little bit better than France, I would say. So what I would like to showcase here is like how now in my GitHub, I build everything, and in my Docker Hub, I have Sneak.io connected to it, which scans the container statically. And it will give me information not only for the jar itself, like if it has libraries that are not compliant or they are not at a good version, okay, but will also tell me the image you are using to build, the base image you are using to build, for example, if it is an Alpine Linux, and Ubuntu and or whatsoever, it will tell you, for example, that it has critical flaws on the libraries that it deploys. And no luck. Anyhow, I will share the slides, and also I will share the code with all of you so that you can replay all those things yourself. Okay, because I prefer if we spend some time to finalize it. Let's go back. Apologies. I mean, it's nice to see slides, but it's better to see that in code. So if there are like 5 or 8 things that I would like you to take away from this discussion we had, is that security should not be easy. If the security in your organization is easy, something is extremely wrong, by definition, okay? Now, on the other hand, you should not be afraid to do security, because this proves that you are a good engineer, okay? Consider machines and humans equals. Everyone needs to have an identity in the new era. Everyone needs to have an identity. If you don't assign identities to your devices, you have a problem. The majority of the Ryuk attacks that happened were privilege escalations that happened from machines that did not have identity controls. People became roots on those things, and then they cannibalized entire infrastructures to there, okay? With a friend who is here in this audience, we tried to build, or we tried to do pre-authentication ourselves, or build a similar IDP for development purposes. You can use, for example, Spring Boot offers an Oath resource server that you can start quickly to check if you are doing properly Oath. When you go to production, go to someone who does it properly. Trust the people that are doing security properly and they know the crypto analysis. Typical example, the discussion, what is a PKI? Most of these people will tell you like, no, we are not doing PKI. You are in a better path, but you are not doing PKI. Trust nothing and no one. I mean, in essence, that's the heart of zero trust, right? Authenticate and authorize everything, machines, network, applications, people, and keep track of that. It's really important. Change the mindset of your security, which is we don't do reactive security. We need to be able to do those things, what it is called, preactive security. I need to be able to see a lateral movement in my infrastructure, which indicates that someone is trying to do something. And you should be able to detect that. There are tools that can be composed together, like Microsoft and also AWS offers such tools that will allow you to infuse AI logic in what they see in your infrastructure and tell you if there is a security incident or not. Trust the people that have spent a lot of time doing security, okay? And I will go a little bit back. In the zero trust model, there is only one flaw. And it's the guy in the middle, the guy in the middle is the problem. The guy in the middle is always the weakest link. That's why automate everything. Don't rely on humans. That sounds a lot like I'm working for the Terminator. But how many of the incidents you have heard in your company or in the world were coming from the guy sitting in the middle who is a really cool guy? It's always a human error driving the beginning of the downfall. Always. Unfortunately, this goes also back to history to many, many occasions. So, going back, as I stated, there are extreme security requirements, like when you are doing in the army security, and there are the other side of it, like people doing no security. Try to be in the middle. Try not to impose military-grade security to your organization or really difficult security requirements. This drives people away. This drives people finding hacks to bypass security. Try to do security properly. Try to do security easily consumable by the mass in your organization, and then you will have a successful security organization and a successful security team implementing security in your organization. Try to fail. No one is, let's say, criticized because he failed. Thank you all for your time. Any questions? Anything that you would like to share as personal experience? Yes.
Maybe on zero trust architectures, do you sign binaries that you ship to containers, or do you even use a notary as a Docker, but trust in whatever you deploy?
No, you don't trust whatever you deploy. There are, at the moment, there are what I wanted to showcase, like Snyk, which are static analysis of your container. It's not something that any static analysis tool of your code will do. It will look at the Docker file, it will look at the container, it will try to mix and match. The important part here is you need to do what is called signed commits at the moment when you do that. So I'm really a huge advocate of signed commits on repositories, right? Like there is where certificates are really important. I need to be able to sign what I submit. There is a ton of incidents you have heard about supply chain attacks, right? Like this is a typical example of how you could save it. And of course, when we speak about the mind shift change in the security model, how you would secure a VM server? You will run an antivirus software. If you try to run an antivirus software in a container, the container will never start, okay? But you have what it is called runtime container scanning. What that does, it says you describe the immutable state that thing needs to go. And if that immutable state does not match the running state, the container dies. The container is not executed. Typical example, I have an Ubuntu. I deploy my jar, my Spring Boot application inside Ubuntu, and I start a container based on that. A typical scanning rule is like, okay, if you see SSH outgoing traffic from the container, stop the container. There are ways to circumvent that, and this is called distroless container. What is a distroless container? It's a container that does not require a full-blown operating system or a Linux-based system, but it has only a kernel and the libraries that are required for your application to run. For example, there are JVM-based distroless containers. You have Python, you have Go, C by default, because you only need the kernel. That's more or less what comes in my mind. But in essence, scan your runtime. That's what you should do. Yes, please.
Thank you very much for the presentation. Basically, the kind of developer that actually delegates all the security to the my friend who is doing all the infrastructure thing. But then you told about the MFA, the double authentication.
Multi-factor authentication.
Multi-factor, yes. And it seems like I don't really follow everything, but it seems like it changes lately, like there were something not very secure about it. And that, for example, in France, I don't know, my bank just sent me a bunch of letters with lot of codes in order to change the to another kind of authentication. And I wanted to know if... I mean, if we can trust MFA, I mean, for some reason, if we can still trust it, or if there are some leaks and what is new now.
Yes, if your bank sent you letters, you need to go, you need to change the bank, because most of the banks now are using applications in your app to generate those.
Yes, but they send the code in order to identify on an application.
Yes, so the multi-factor authentication, okay, is a concept that states, in order for me to authenticate my identity, is something that I own, an attribute that I have, and something that I share. What is the problem that it tries to solve, and why you need to trust it? So imagine your credentials for your web banking system are lost. If you didn't have MFA, anyone with your credentials could go inside your web banking system and do everything on your behalf, and you could not claim anything to the bank, right? Now the bank will give you an application that it will say, okay, let's say that your credentials are compromised, okay, and someone tries to do a bank transfer. In your device, which is your second factor, okay, that can be a device in another application, it can be a biometric sensor, whatever, right? Something will pop up and will say, oh, by the way, you as a person are doing something in a system that requires another factor of authentication. Do you approve? What is the problem you are solving there? Even though your credentials are compromised, still the system will block the action. And for many banks, such behavior is a trigger of a compromise. So MFA compared to a federated authentication are two complementary technologies. It's not that you will do one or the other. They should go hand in hand, right? So many times also a lot of companies are using these codes in a written form to recover from a loss of your MFA client. That's why most of the times you receive that in a paper form. Even in GitHub or in Docker Hub, when you will enable MFA, it will tell you, please download these 6 codes, because in case your device is lost or you change your device or something happened, you can use this code to identify yourself uniquely. Okay? So it's not exclusive, it's complementary. That thing is bleeping here. Thank you all again.